What an uplifting performance. Thank you to Favianna Rodriguez and the Ndlovu Youth Choir for sharing your art and your voices with us. My name is Soledad O'Brien, and it is my honor to be your host today. Welcome to the W.K. Kellogg Foundation's 6th Annual National Day of Racial Healing. We renew our commitment to this important work at the start of every year and on the heels of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, a reminder of our duty to celebrate and to continue the legacy of action for equal rights and justice for all. Reflecting on the past year, I'm reminded of an old saying about progress. It doesn't get any easier, you just get better at it. From the enduring challenges of a virus that has disproportionately impacted our Black and brown communities to the devastating biases that continue to produce disparate outcomes everywhere in our schools and neighborhoods, in our courts and prisons, The fight for racial equity certainly hasn't gotten any easier. And yet, our hands have grown steadier and interconnected in this work. Our voices have grown louder and clearer in their message. Members of our communities have organized to take up space in calling for change and making room for healing. They've built coalitions to strengthen movements and our communities. In 2021, a record number of women and Black women CEOs made the Fortune 500. Young activists led charges for voting rights, climate justice, and racial justice on and offline. For the first time in our country's history, Indigenous Peoples Day was officially recognized by presidential proclamation. And after a year of increased violence and hate directed at their communities, Asian Americans made history at the ballot box in cities across America. And there's much more work to be done to continue this progress. While we cannot physically share the same space today, I'm inspired by all the incredible organizers, activists, and community leaders joining us in conversation and as viewers from across the country. In bringing together the diversity of our perspectives and learning from the wisdom of our lived experiences, we can shape the future into one that's brighter, better, and more just for the next generation. For more than 8 years, as the first female and African-American president and CEO of the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, Ðinh Montgomery Tabron has been spearheading that work on behalf of children and families in communities in need. From early childhood education to equitable employment opportunities and community empowerment, under Ðinh's leadership, the W.K. Kellogg Foundation has made systemic change possible. She believes that racial healing is the foundation required to create the conditions for all families and children to thrive. It is with great gratitude to Ðinh and the foundation that I'm here today, and I'm looking forward to the conversations and the work ahead. We'll be hearing from Ðinh, as well as our incredible performers and panelists, momentarily. Throughout the event, we invite you all to visit dayofracialhealing.org to download our action kits and learn more about how to get involved in this work. Don't forget to use the chat box as well and help us continue the conversation online using the hashtag #HowWeHeal. And now, here to open with a land acknowledgement, please join me in welcoming hip-hop artist and fancy dancer, Supaman.
Kahe, balasha awe age march lahuk, biyashi chidik in ababe itchik. Hello, my good relatives. My name is Christian Parrish, takes the gun, a.k.a. Supaman. Come from the Upsaliga Nation in Montana, or the Crow Nation is the mistranslation of our people. My Upsaliga name is Aweagemachla, which means good fortune on Mother Earth. My clan is the Yashichira, which is the Big Lodge clan. And it is my honor to be joining you today. I want to give thanks to all the elders of my people, the Upsaliga, past and present, for watching over this land where I am now in southeastern Montana. Before we begin a process of healing, it's also customary for us to uplift our medicines and start off in a prayerful way by smudging with the medicines of sweetgrass or cedar or whatever different medicines that, you know, different tribes use to start off in a prayerful way. We uplift these gifts that the Creator has given us. Some of these gifts we've inherited in the form of languages also, stories, food, songs, our dances, the traditions of our people, which in themselves are a form of healing. They give us strength, remind us of the resilience of our roots, and inspire us to move forward in a world that tried to erase us. As we gather here today, it is essential that we ground ourselves in a foundation of truth-telling, acknowledging the unceded territory of Native peoples at events like this is a way of paying respect to the communities who, for generations, lived on and with the land we now occupy. The mountains, the rivers, the plains, the prairies, the elements, trees, stone, soil, they all tell a story. They tell the stories of the people whose centuries of stewardship nurtured the places we now call home. But they also bear the scars of conflict and coercion that went into acquiring these lands and are a part of our history too. In reflecting on our past and learning from the stories it tells, we empower ourselves with the wisdom necessary to do the work of justice and reconciliation. I would now like to take a moment to remember our relatives who have recently transitioned because of the coronavirus. Like many communities that have experienced systemic oppression and exploitation, the Indigenous community was hit especially hard by the effects of the pandemic. And as we remember those who have transitioned during COVID, we must also name the other ongoing epidemic afflicting our people, the continued and largely ignored disappearance of our Native people. We will not rest in our search for them or in our pursuit for justice. For them, and in solidarity with the murdered and missing Indigenous people movement, and for all those in the First Nations communities mourning today, we lift up their memories. Though we cannot recognize all the peoples who once lived in each of the locations represented at today's virtual gathering, all of us can do that important work on our own. I encourage all of you to take a moment to look into the Indigenous history of your area. Learn the names of the people, their languages. Learn about their culture, traditions, their practices. Seek out and support the work being done all across the country today to repair the various harms caused by the loss of land and the conflict brought upon Indigenous communities. We are all here because we believe in the power of healing. Because we believe that, together, we can create a more just and equitable world for generations to come. Ahu.
Over the past 5 years, we have come together as individuals, communities, and organizations to acknowledge the values we share as people. Together, we have worked to restore our trust in each other. Together, we have built authentic relationships and inspired collective action on how we heal from the effects of systemic racism. Last January, in the wake of the violent insurrection that occurred on January 6th, hundreds of thousands of people joined us at this virtual event and through more than 100 local events held across the nation. When we create safe spaces where truth-telling and uncomfortable conversations can happen, we have hope that healing can happen. That is how we advance racial equity. We are so honored to be back together for this 6th annual day to continue the work to create a more racially equitable society. Racial healing is that work. Today, we begin to move from conversation to action. You will hear from an array of subject matter experts and practitioners who will share their insights and solutions on the themes of racial healing and solidarity and how we create a path forward and achieve racial equity. There is a role for all of us to play. I've been so inspired by our next generation of leaders, many of whom are watching us live today, because together you realize that this moment of racial reckoning doesn't have to be a moment. It can become a movement of solidarity where we heal together and build a world that is not just a better one, but an equitable one. I'm delighted to welcome one of these young leaders, Connie Brownotter. Connie is a student leader at Montana State University and an Indigenous activist from the Standing Rock Sioux Nation. What I love about Connie's leadership is that she starts from a place of love, mutual respect, and empathy. Connie has been with us before, and I'm excited to catch up with her. Before we get started, I want to know how you are feeling and managing during these tough times. You have a lot of things going on with being an activist and a student. How are you doing? How are you healing now, both spiritually and emotionally?
I'm still growing every single day. I feel like it kind of stemmed, though, from kind of focusing on that individual healing, that individual spiritual growth that I wanted for myself, and that emotional growth that I wanted for myself. And I had to start with me. I had to start internally, and just a lot of, like, changing my habits, changing my mentality, the way I think to myself or think about myself. And I think I've been doing good.
I always feel like the next generation of leaders are more politically, socially, and culturally engaged than ever. I know you value and respect your culture and traditions. I recall you saying before that it's hard to balance your aspirations to lead while also respecting the world you walk in. How is an intergenerational approach helpful to you in this work? And how can we make sure the voices of young people are heard?
As a young person, it's kind of, it is my responsibility to use my voice. It is my responsibility to take up some space. And if someone invites me to sit at the table, I will gladly take a seat. One of the things that I like to consider a lot when I think of my work is how can we get perspectives from different backgrounds, not just from the youth, but like valuing the words, the wisdom, the knowledge of our elderly people. People who already know what works right now and what doesn't work, and what fresh ideas can we bring into the scene, and what, you know, how can we address and assess risks and changes? So the WK Kellogg Foundation has been working on a lot of these issues for many years. What knowledge can you share for those who want to continue and build upon this work in the future?
Thank you, Connie, for that question. Yes, we have been at this for a very long time. I believe it's been our entire existence. But the most important thing that I think we've learned and we value more than anything is to make sure that the authentic perspectives are those voices from the community. And we know that we must be in service to those voices. I would like to hear from you about the issues that are most important to you and your community. What are the systems and structures that need change? How can we work to ensure voices from Indigenous communities are centered as well as leading the conversations aligned to these issues?
I do want to acknowledge that Indigenous people in this country face many unique barriers that are a direct result of this nation's history of colonization and violence. I feel like addressing that reality of our history is that first step to that healing process. So when you meet a Native person like myself and you ask me, how does it impact you on a personal level? I can tell you exactly, you know, why I am the way that I am, the way that I think, the way I was raised. And it's tied to the history of this nation and colonization and violence and power issues and inequities. But through my story, you'll see traces of that history there, for sure. But you'll also see the ways in which I've overcome a lot of those challenges, the ways I've been supported in growing from these hardships, the ways I've exhibited resilience in my daily life, the ways that I uplift others, and the way that I am a positive force of change. And I don't feel like my history has to be my future.
I'm so happy to have you here with us today and to just feel your energy, even though we can't be in the same room together. Where do you get your inspiration from? What inspires you and keeps you motivated to do this work?
I draw my energy, my power from like reflecting on my culture, my heritage, my background, the way I was raised, the values that were instilled in like my day-to-day life as a child to being a young adult now. I feel like I have an obligation to honor the legacy that my ancestors gave to me. And I'm here, and we're here as Native people. We're living, we're thriving, we're not going anywhere. And we have voices that matter, voices that carry weight. And I feel like there's change within our reach, within this generation. And I see my community, and I see my peers, and I see myself as part of the solution to a lot of these issues that we face collectively.
I'm just so impressed by your leadership. Definitely a model for what truth, storytelling, and healing is all about. So thank you. I've been honored to speak with you.
Welcome to the shores of Avavamalu, the place where the sun first hits on the island of Oahu. We're here to honor our ancestors, our Indigenous people, and the Native Hawaiians of Hawaii. This morning's oli, or blessing, speaks about the metaphor of a fog lifting and a beautiful lehua blossom arriving and showing its presence. When you receive this oli or this chant, please think about someone that you haven't seen in a while, someone that you may have not even talked to during the COVID months. Imagine them arising from that fog and from that mist. The things that we put out into the universe really do manifest. And so please welcome this oli aloha, imagining that racial healing will be lifted, that we will become the people that we see beyond that. Mahalo for all of you to joining in this morning. Please think about your loved ones. Please think about each other as we journey toward racial healing. Oh, now nai ka hala me kale huai. He halele hua no ya na ka no he. Oh, ka uno ya ya no inei. E li anei ho io ka hiki mai. Ah, hiki mai no ogo. Ah, hiki puno me ke aloha. Aloha e, aloha e, aloha e, aloha. Please enjoy this wonderful day.
Thank you, Dr. Paloma, for your welcome chant. And thank you all for joining us here today. My name is Julissa Calderon. I am an actress. I am an activist. I am an Afro-Latina. And I am extremely honored to be here today with some incredible people to moderate this discussion about racial healing and solidarity. Growing up in South Florida, I spent my childhood embracing my Latina heritage. My Blackness was not something that I ever really acknowledged until I was older and understood. I wasn't considered Black in my neighborhood because I spoke Spanish. There is still so much internalized racism and colorism that we need to unlearn. But now I embrace that identity because it allows other people to understand it. I am proud to be a Latina. I am proud of my African roots. And I am proud to be an example for all the other Afro-Latina girls across the country. Now, I told you that I was here with some amazing people, and I want to introduce someone who is an expert in what I've been talking about, in advocacy and building solidarity across racial lines. His name is Kent Wong, and he is the director of the UCLA Labor Center. Kent, thank you for being with us here today.
Thank you so much, Julissa, and so great to be with you today. My work has really very much been at the intersection of economic justice and racial justice, and they are deeply interconnected. The modern labor laws that guide this nation were developed in the decade of the 1930s during the Great Depression. And while this was a huge breakthrough to, for the first time, provide basic rights for workers in this country to form and join unions and to collectively bargain, it was also deliberately exclusive of many groups of workers, especially women, people of color, and immigrants. My beginnings as a boycott organizer with the United Farm Workers of America taught me that the very foundation of the United Farm Workers of America was a alliance between a Filipino-American labor organization and a Mexican labor organization that brought to birth the United Farm Workers of America under the leadership of Cesar Chavez, Dolores Huerta, and my good friend Philip Veracruz. I have seen the power of multiracial organizing that lifts us all up, especially now during the pandemic. This is the racial healing, the solidarity, and the economic and racial justice that our communities desperately need.
And I know you talked about collaboration, and that is an extremely powerful tool, not only in the work of racial healing, but in every pursuit of racial equity and justice. And for more building strong coalitions, I'd like to turn to Linda Sarsour. Linda is an activist and organizer. She's also the co-founder of the Women's March Until Freedom and Empower Change. Linda, thank you as well for being here and for lending us your voice and just for fighting fighting for women like me. You've spent years organizing at the grassroots level. How have you built intersectionality into your work? Specifically, how have you approached this truth-telling and these uncomfortable conversations across race and ethnicity in your work?
You know, I've been doing this work for about 20 years now, since the horrific attacks of 9/11. And I got to see the very community that I'm from, people who look like me, who look like my fathers, like my brothers, literally targeted by law enforcement. I watched men in our community detained, separated from their children. And that is really my radicalizing moment. So I started understanding the intersections of oppression, anti-Black racism, xenophobia, homophobia, Islamophobia, anti-Semitism. It really was, for me, became like this tree of racism, and all of us were kind of branches on this tree. And in order for this tree to live, we had to all come in solidarity, and that's where the roots come from. It's not possible for us to always believe the same things or to show up in the same ways, because we are different people. We grew up differently. We are from different communities. I believe that unity is not uniformity, that we can organize in a space where basic principles are what we adhere to. Dignity for all people, that everybody deserves to live in this world safely and free from targeting, that we all don't just survive, that we thrive. And that doesn't require you to be part of a political party or be on the left or the right. That just requires you to be someone with basic humanity and dignity.
I want to go ahead and pass the mic now as well to Dr. Denese Shervington. Dr. Shervington is the founder and CEO of the Institute of Women and Ethnic Studies and a professor of psychiatry at the Tulane University School of Medicine. You wrote an important book on racial healing, Healing is the Revolution, and it came out in 2018. And a lot has changed in the world since 2018, although it was only a few years ago, but so much has impacted our world, specifically COVID. How has COVID challenged or reaffirmed what we knew about racial healing before this pandemic?
What we have seen with the pandemic is just the exposure of just multiple layers of inequities. And for me as a physician, of course, that turned up mostly in health. We now have to have the conversation about extensive, pre-existing, and visible inequities in the face of this invisible threat, the pandemic. But what has happened with the toxicity of white supremacy, and to me, one of the major issues there, is that the people who are othered are perceived as being inferior. When one group claims superiority, that's usually is at the expense of the other. And the other then is seen as not deserving. Racial healing as individuals and as a community, I think it requires us to get back to that deep knowing that we are one, that we have to care for each other, and that our liberation happens together.
I'm going to redirect this again to Mr. Kent Wong. What do you feel are the most pressing issues right now at the current climate, and where do you think we go from here?
We are in the middle of the worst pandemic in over 100 years. And the tragedy is that not all within our society are facing the pandemic in the same way. The pandemic has also seen billionaires making billions in profits. The stock market is shattering new records. The housing market, especially the upper end housing market, is going through the roof, literally. We have millions and millions of people in this country who are food insecure, who are facing homelessness and the threat of eviction. So this is the reality that we face. And when we talk about racial healing, it is how can we understand the commonality that brings our communities together, and at the same time, understand very conscious and deliberate moves to try to move in the other direction and to pit us against one another. The solution must be to understand the deep roots that bind us together. When we stand together and advocate for, work for racial and economic justice, we can achieve wonderful things together. And so that is the spirit of racial healing that I keep with me every day.
How do we keep the momentum that Kat just spoke on? How do we keep this momentum going for the long run?
So we have no choice but to keep the momentum. There are people who currently, right now, today, who are still impacted by homelessness, by poverty. We still have Black and Brown people being killed at the hands of law enforcement across this country, at the hands of gun violence across this country. We have people in our communities who die every day because they don't have access to adequate healthcare. It's about what is injustice and what are we ready to do to get justice for our people. There are people in our communities who, it's not that they're voiceless, it's that they don't yet have the tools or the platforms to fight for justice for themselves. So they count on organizers and activists and academics and people, labor unions and others to do the kind of grassroots work in the communities. Our people every day count on us to be on the streets. That's why for me, I always say to people, you know, when do you stop doing this work? And I say, well, you stop doing this work when you stop loving your people.
None of us can underestimate the power of personal connection and shared community. That's what it's all about. But I want to start with Dr. Shervington. I was wondering if you could share your perspective on what the charge is. What can people do to move forward with truth telling and healing as essential steps to achieve racial equity? And can you share actually practical examples for those listening?
It really means starting to understand what the root causes of racism are. You would be surprised how many of us in our communities, in BIPOC communities, don't understand the history of where the separation started. Many of us don't know the history. And in particular in the African-American community, many of us don't understand, you know, from scholars like Brian Smedley, who talked about race as culturally invented by other humans to show up human difference, and then to use that as a mechanism to limit access to privilege, power, and wealth. And then in doing the work, then we have to understand how that racism turns up in our minds, in our bodies, and how it can even diminish and extinguish, to me, the beautiful light of our souls and a kind of inherent jouissance that we have about our existence.
Racial healing means action. Dr. Martin Luther King and the Freedom Riders and the people that staged sit-ins and put their lives on the line for justice. So we are all the beneficiaries of that movement. We have to engage in the fight for voting rights. We have to engage in the fight to end mass incarceration and the criminalization of communities of color, and especially Black men. And we have to engage in the fight for full rights for 11 million undocumented immigrants who are our essential workers and who are locked in an apartheid-style system where forever they're denied basic rights as human beings within our society. When we talk about racial healing, it is a collective action. It is an action that binds us together and grows a future where we can envision the beloved community that we all seek.
Sometimes it's just about being there for somebody that may not have somebody other than you. That is the most powerful form of solidarity, showing up. But we got to get back to the basics. It's about your neighbors. It's about, you can't go heal Chicago if you can't heal your street in Brooklyn, if you can't even have a conversation, if you don't even know who the person down the hall that lives in your apartment, but you don't even know their name. We're taught individualism in America, every man and woman and person for themselves. So there's a lot of unlearning that we have to do. There's a lot of ways for us to show up for one another. And I think that that's the essence that we've been missing right now. And also the rage that we bring, you know, our anger comes from love, and it comes from a place of wanting to heal. I just want people to know that don't be ashamed of rage, rage in the face of injustice, that's a normal process.
We all share the air that we breathe, the oxygen that we need to live. And I think from that space, if we could all tap into that truth of our humanity, that we belong to each other, that we're responsible for each other, that as human beings, we cannot survive without each other.
It is so important for all of us to recognize the ways that our identity and our experience are shaped and shared by the world that is around us. And I'm sure that anyone that's watching and anyone that's listening has been inspired by each and every one of you today to fight and to continue and to look for the hope in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Flint is an amazing, beautiful, and complex city.
If you ever need to be encouraged or inspired by the real grit of humanity, you will find that in Flint.
The water crisis was a moment in our history, the Flint city history, where 100,000 people, that includes aging seniors and 10,000 0-to-5-year-olds, were exposed to lead in their drinking water.
When most people think of the Flint water crisis, they think of lead, but it was really much more than that. It started with a crisis of democracy. That really created a crisis of trust in government at all levels.
How do we remediate these type of environmental injustices? How do we move forward working together for low to moderate income areas, black and brown communities? We definitely have to value each other as human beings first.
The water crisis really acted as a catalyst. It provided an opportunity to really have meaningful conversations about race.
The underpinnings of truth, racial healing, and transformation teach us that we place the hierarchy on the value of human life, and how that shows up in our society is people have differential access to health care or goods or services or quality housing.
We began to bring in healing practitioners to support the grounding that's going to be necessary to see one another in our common humanity.
How do you begin the process to do your work while other people are doing their work, and you're willing and open enough to do it together?
Multi-sector problems require multi-sector solutions. The ways that we had to partner to get through the water crisis was also the systems that we needed to build to be able to respond to whatever crisis come in the future.
We developed a partnership with the city of Flint around a public housing initiative called Choice Neighborhoods. We have undertaken the COVID-19 Task Force on Racial Inequities.
Post George Floyd, there were a number of commitments around what we would do to engage police in the most authentic ways, to support police engaging community in the most authentic ways.
We had our entire local police force participate in the healing circles.
And that also allowed us to look at some very specific changes in policies and practices that we're going to elevate. We're going to put forth a report to the police chief and support advocacy around healthier environment for police to serve in. As a racial healing practitioner, it's part of my role to create a space for people to speak their truths.
Right, but ultimately, healing comes from the inside out. So it first starts with the work we need to do within.
I can see the difference in our police force. I can see the engagement and the morale being lifted because now they understand how to de-escalate situations, how not to be so fearful of people because of their color.
Truth, racial healing, and transformation work is so important in Flint because much of what has happened in Flint has its underpinnings in racial inequity and systemic and structural racism.
In order for us to reestablish the level of trust in this community, we have to inspire a level of hope.
It's transformational because you do the work, but the world seems different. More seems possible. Partnerships seem possible, where before they weren't.
Now we're in a much better place. We recognize who we are and what the task is ahead of us.
I don't think I've been involved in any circle that has really been a negative experience or that didn't have some type of impact.
When you look out at your community and humanity is front and center, and the contributions that community get to bring to bear, you say, man, what a beautiful world.
Wow. What an incredible story. The movement in Flint, Michigan serves as a profound reminder of the human cost of systemic inequity and the importance of approaching systems change with a lens of racial equity and healing. At the core of truth, racial healing and transformation is the belief that we can unlearn the biases that foment racism. We know that when we work across identities and invite more people and perspectives to join us in the conversation, we can move from divisiveness to solidarity and from competition to community. And that gives us the strength we need to face important truths, the difficult truths of our complicated and profoundly unjust past, and the hopeful truths of our shared interdependent future. Once we face these truths together, how do we transform institutions to reflect them? How do we change systems larger and older than any one of us? How do we move forward? They're important questions, and they're questions that our next set of panelists have dedicated their work and their lives to answering. We'll be hearing from some of the leading minds in health equity, civil rights, behavioral science, immigrant and refugee justice, and education. But first, please join me in welcoming our next guests, poet, artist, and organizer, Reyes, joined by artist and activist, John Legend, for a very special performance.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. And I wish I could say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole round world to hear.
From the ancestral homelands, birds fly free of the Three Fires Confederacy, Odawa, Ojibwe, Potawatomi. Beyond politics and trickery, true trauma healing, truth telling told is necessary. Ugly, messy mixes, emotionally moving in frame, flash, focus, record. Historic truth must be remixed and rescored. Whether alhamdulillah, said in tongues, praise to the Lord. Humanity shared, families cared, our music remembered, nurtured relationships to build and repair. Systematic oppression that constantly glares, our shared humanity in the bang of stars, fire and flare. I find freedom from there. I find freedom from there.
I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the bars that keep us apart. And I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you'd see and agree that every man should be free.
So we work toward collective liberation, working toward collaborate and advocate for local transformation, healing from the pain of white supremacy on high level sonic vibration, reverberation, black and Mexicano, luchando mano a mano, see in translation, coming together to repair the harms of racism beyond just this nation. We speak with fire and strength and voice and sound, ancestors drum, dance and speak from the underground, plant seeds to build movements, community power, seeds grow, bloom and flower, roses from the concrete, we rose from the concrete with plans concrete to organize, march, build, and be reborn. We use the sound to heal and transform, united through rhythms and waves to hit your eardrum. Words felt on the tips of a tongue, counter-narrative poem. The pen is mightier than the gun. I'm no more than a native son, standing in the shadow of the sun, looking up at branches where strange fruit once hung. Healing with dance and song as we listen to ancient hymns sung. As we listen to ancient hymns sung.
Well, I wish I could be like the bird up in the sky. How sweet it would be if I found I could fly. Oh, I'd soar to the sun, then I'd look down at the sea, and I'd sing 'cause I know. I'd sing 'cause I know. Oh, I'd sing sing, 'cause I know how it feels to be free.
To be free, to be free, to be free.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rochelle Riley. I am a writer by trade, warrior by necessity. But our conversation today is with experts in perception and law and identity. We recognize the importance of building solidarity across communities. To get us started, please welcome Rachel Godsil. Rachel, you've written dozens of groundbreaking reports on implicit bias and stereotype threat. What have you learned from your research about how racism and trauma affect us as individuals and communities, and how to change the way people talk about racism?
As a white woman doing this work, I've really been conscious, have always been in the many decades of doing the work, but I think particularly in recent years, of just what it means that as a person who's white, my life experience is so different from the colleagues who I work with so closely, from the people I care about so deeply. The idea of implicit bias, these automatic associations of stereotypes and attitudes toward particular groups, where if something about our identity is triggered in a context, it can deeply undermine how we show up. By sharing those phenomena across every sector that matters, the healthcare sector, the criminal legal system, education, the workplace, in all of those contexts, the structural inequalities that exist are, in a sense, manifested in moment-to-moment behaviors that, if those continue, the cumulative effect is to exacerbate those very systemic inequalities.
To talk about those compounding effects, I want to turn to Dr. David Williams, who developed the most widely used measure of discrimination in health studies, the Everyday Discrimination Scale. His life's work has been focused on the way social factors materially impact our physical and mental health, often in harmful ways. David, I want us to jump right in on how we can help each other heal from those harms and prevent them in the future.
I do think people should have a sense, though, before I talk about how we heal, have a sense of the degree of the harms that are caused by interpersonal discrimination. The good news is science has also identified there are multiple resources at the individual level that can cushion the negative effects of discrimination on health. Let me give you an example of one study. A study of African-American teenagers in Georgia. Those teens who were embedded in positive social relationships with their parents, with their friends, with their teachers, the quality of social ties broke the relationship, destroyed that relationship between exposure to discrimination and physiological dysregulation. Let me give you a second study. National data on African Americans found that higher levels of discrimination led to higher rates of depression and depressive symptoms in African Americans. But religious involvement was a resource. Frequency of religious attendance, frequency of receiving support from members at your place of worship, and looking to God for guidance in your daily life. Each of those three mechanisms reduced the negative effects of exposure to discrimination on mental health. One last study, it was a study of First Nation communities where the Indigenous youth in Canada at the time of the study had the highest rates of youth suicide in the world. And they were surprised. Half of the 196 First Nations communities they studied had had no suicides at all. Although as a group, this population had the highest rates of suicide. So they began to wonder what makes a difference. And they identified markers of empowerment, markers of protest to the federal government in Canada. Those communities that were protesting and fighting for control over the services they provided to the community, fighting for titles to land and property, and having places in their community where they celebrated their culture and youth were learned to pride themselves in their history and their culture. So actually, Protests and empowerment and engagement and working for others is actually a powerful resource that can cushion the negative effects of exposure to discrimination and stress on health.
I'd like to ask our next panelist, Quyên, Executive Director of the Southeast Asia Resource Action Center, otherwise known as CRAC. Can you tell us about the work that you've been doing and what racial healing and justice mean to your work?
For CRAC, what's most important to understand is that we represent the largest community of refugees ever to be resettled in America. I am so proud to identify as a second generation Vietnamese American, but our communities would not have been here had American allies not have stood up and protected our rights to be, to live and to be free. And not only that, this is a history that would not have been made possible without the solidarity of African-American communities, from the Black Panther movement to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. to Black Americans who stood up for the resettlement of refugees. Three major rights that we fight to protect every day: our rights to be seen, our right to heal, and our right to family. Our right to be seen in particular in this moment with COVID is so particularly important because this is where we see the importance of data disaggregation and its ability to reveal so many traumas. It was the power of local communities who called for data disaggregation that revealed higher incidences of COVID for Southeast Asian and Pacific Islander communities in particular, who we know experience long-term poverty, who have experienced traumas from being survivors of war and genocide, as well as having higher prevalences of previous health conditions and chronic health conditions that have made our communities more vulnerable to COVID.
I want to talk about alliances a minute, because history has been filled with these moments of alliance, whether it was Jewish Americans and African Americans at the turn of the 20th century. Are you seeing those types of alliances? Is that where we need to be?
What is top of mind are the refugees from Afghanistan that are happening right now.
Yes.
And the moment that we saw the airports closing, the Vietnamese American and Southeast Asian American community immediately saw our histories of being rushed to rushed in Saigon to get on the last planes to get out of Vietnam. And it was, for me, incredible to see the community respond in solidarity with fundraising efforts to resettle new Afghan families, to support local and national organizing efforts to make sure that we accepted as many Afghan refugees as possible, and to make sure that we retold the story of Southeast Asian American refugees and the incredible contributions that we have made as a community to this country. This is the organizing that we have seen happen across the country and has been so phenomenal. We know that this country has done it before, and we know that we can do it again, but this time better.
Thank you. I love that. Give me hope. I know that there are people listening to this conversation and people who will talk about this who will be stunned by the studies, because so often we see people who literally just have not believed how hard it is. And I can tell you that after the death of George Floyd, I, for one, became the Black Google and Black therapist for a lot of people who literally had so many questions about African-American history, about pain, about suffering, things that they just literally either just never had to think about, never had to deal with. It's almost as if this was this other world that was open to them. How do we take advantage of that in a way that makes sense?
We need to take advantage of the moment, but we also can't hold on to our blinders so strongly that we refuse to see the truth. One of the challenges is many Americans overstate the degree of racial progress and think, you know, yes, there was racism in the past with Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement. All those problems were solved back in the 1960s. And maybe today, Blacks actually have an advantage because of affirmative action. And they're just not in touch with the reality. So finding ways and being open to learn and understand the degree of racial inequity that still persists in our society today.
Rachel, you know, I think that that's one of the things that's hardest for some people who have, you know, sort of embraced this American history and seen it in a certain way for so long. And all of a sudden now it seems there's this effort to change the history, but it's not changing the history. It's just really finally addressing the totality of history. How do we overcome this sense that America might be losing something by embracing its truth?
For a lot of white people who are in a place of kind of shame and guilt about where we are, we have to refocus away from that shame and guilt and enter the story with all the communities that comprise this country. One of the ways to perhaps think about what this moment might allow is for the idea that those who are white can be part of a multiracial coalition together, that it doesn't have to be a binary.
I want to go back to the point that has been made by both of my colleagues today about the importance of stories, the importance of narrative. Yes. Because one of the things we have to do is we need to build empathy. When we feel the pain of others, then we are mobilized to say, this is unacceptable, and we have to do something about it. And what the research indicates is that there is a huge racial gap in empathy. The feeling comes, those positive emotions come from seeing stories that we can identify with, and then it changes how we feel, and it changes our openness to saying we need to change things, we need to do better. We need to create safe spaces where people can talk, but we also need to think of initiatives where we can now begin to share those stories, share those narratives that have been hidden, so that we can break down these barriers that we have and that are deeply embedded in our socialization, and that we can see the common humanity in all of ourselves and recognize the dignity in every human being we encounter.
And Quyên, how about you? Based on your experience in the communities you work with, what are some practical recommendations that you would give to those listening today, especially younger people, those future policymakers, on how to create pathways to healing, advocacy, and policy transformation?
It really comes down to continuing your journey of learning. If anything today sparked a curiosity for you, we invite you to learn more about our organizations, learn more about our work, follow us, be part of the Southeast Asian American movement or these other movements to really dismantle racial injustice.
Well, I have to ask this of all three of you, because that is the answer. We have to create these safe spaces. We have to create these initiatives where we can share stories and see each other. Whose job is it?
It's our job. It's all of our job. I like to end many of my talks with a quote from Robert Kennedy. And he said, each time a man or woman stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he or she sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And those ripples can build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance. And I encourage myself every day, and I encourage my audiences, be a ripple of hope. And together, we can change things. We can't wait for others to do it. We need to do our part, and others will follow us, and each one of us can be a ripple of hope.
The sad reality is we're living through a moment in which many people refuse to hear the truth, but that doesn't mean we should stop pushing to make them. We have to stop teaching the American myth and teach the American truth. We cannot omit the centuries of enslavement and free labor that made America. We have to have truthful conversations about who we've been and who we are, because that, when we start to share, is when we really see ourselves. Thank you, all of you, for sharing your knowledge and your experiences and for reminding us that in this work, we are never alone, and for giving us hope that the future that we choose will be the future we can leave our children. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As we near the end of this year's event, I want to reiterate what an honor it has been to be your host. I began my career in journalism 30 years ago, guided by a simple mission: to uncover the truth, no matter how challenging or uncomfortable it might be. It's an ethos that I've recognized in so many of the conversations we've had today, conversations grounded in the understanding that truth is the foundation on which a more equitable society can and must be built. Truth is the foundation for all healing. And the stories we've heard today are proof that healing does follow, that this work, in all of its stages, continues to get done. Across industries and sectors, across race and gender and sexual identities, across generations, in communities in every corner of the world. Great pain calls for great healing. And so, not in spite of the strife and struggle of the past year, but because of it, the work of healing has continued and expanded. As the pandemic fanned the flames of racism, xenophobia, and health inequity, we faced a choice. allow the pain of isolation and the fear of the virus to drive us apart or come together against the forces that divide us. And so many of us have chosen to come together. We came together to push back against Asian hate, to reaffirm that Black lives matter, to demand change from our justice system and law enforcement. We chose to confront injustices and, as today's panelists have made clear, we doubled down in our work to create solutions that heal the wounds and repair the harms of racism. Today has been an important reminder for all of us that progress is always possible and that the path ahead, long and winding as it may be, leads in only one direction, forward. The conversations we've had today have been a step down that path. But the journey doesn't end here. There's still so much to be done, so much to learn and fight for and celebrate. And so, as long as we remain committed to doing so together, we can be the change we want to see. We can make racial equity not a far-off dream, but something we see around us every day in affordable health care, good-paying jobs, and quality education. I am inspired by the many leaders watching today who are fighting to bring racial healing to their own communities every day. Thank you. And for those of you who want to begin this journey for yourself and your community, visit dayofracialhealing.org to download our action kits to learn how to get started. We invite you all to take a minute or two to fill out our quick survey via the link in the chat box and to continue today's conversation online using the hashtag How We Heal. It is now my pleasure to turn it back over to Lejeune Montgomery Tabron.
Thank you, Soledad, for introducing this final conversation today and for hosting this entire event. We appreciate you. And to close today's program, I am delighted to speak with my friend and colleague, Heather McGhee. For me, this is a beautiful circle of life moment. Heather is the author of the New York Times bestseller, The Sum of Us, What Racism Costs Everyone, and How We Can Prosper Together. But she's also an expert in economic and social policy and a multi-generational member of our Kellogg Foundation family. Her mother, Gail Christopher, led our racial equity work at the foundation and was instrumental in co-creation of the first National Day of Racial Healing. Heather was a founding member of the foundation's Solidarity Council on Racial Equity, which is designed to inspire more people to actively pursue equity. I love that we have a chance to reconnect, Heather. And Heather, welcome.
Thank you, Lejeune, and happy Day of Racial Healing to you. This has been a beautiful program.
Heather, your book is very pertinent to the work we are doing to achieve racial equity and healing. And I really want to share your views with the audience. In the book, you describe how many people see race as a zero-sum game. Please tell us about this theory and why it is the wrong and even harmful way to look at such an important and integral aspect of every issue and challenge we face today.
I wrote the book, The Sum of Us, out of a real hunger to figure out what is stymieing American progress. What's holding us back? We are one of the wealthiest nations in the world, and yet we have such high rates of child poverty. We have such dysfunction in our politics. There's so many ways in which we could and should be doing so much better. And one of the first insights I came across was this worldview, this story that too many people believe, this story that is sold in our society by powerful economic and political elites out of a sense of self-interest. It's a story that says that we are at odds with one another, that we're not on the same team, that progress for one group has to come at the expense of others. It's this racial zero sum. When you really look at it, you can see how it's a lie. It's about naming the zero sum, exposing its lie, holding accountable those who are selling it for their own profit, and finding a way to recognize that we really are on the same team and we rise or fall together.
A favorite passage of mine from your book, Heather, was where you write, "I found that the people who had replaced the zero sum with a new formula of cross-racial solidarity had found the key to unlocking what I began to call a solidarity dividend, from higher wages to cleaner air, made possible through collective action. Tell us about the solidarity dividend. What does it mean, and how does it apply to our racial equity and healing work?
It's the idea that no one should have to fight alone. And so this idea of the solidarity dividend was, for me, from an economic orientation, it was about replacing the zero-sum paradigm that has led to racism having so many economic costs in our society, racism in our politics and our policymaking, leading to us really shortchanging common solutions to our common problems, us really having a higher level of distrust of government than we should because government has become so racialized in our politics, replacing that whole old paradigm of the racial zero sum with the idea that if we come together through collective action, and in our context, that's gotta be multiracial collective action, right? We are hurtling towards a point in American history where there will be no racial majority. And so in every community in the country, in one way or another, to really get collective action to solve big challenges, it's gotta be across lines of race and culture and origin and often language. Philanthropy plays such an important role, is a real linchpin in our ecosystem of winning social change, including public policy. So I would love to hear from you. What's your vision? How do you see philanthropy playing a role in furthering social change, particularly around issues of racial healing and equity in these very divided times?
I believe we are in a moment right now, and it's a moment of opportunity. And there's something different about the level of awareness related to racial equity and really a desire to move to action. What we can do is lean into that momentum and to help support people who are reimagining what an equitable nation could mean for everyone. And I, you know, when I think about your word, a solidarity dividend, to really help support people as they think about changing that paradigm and understanding what's in it for them.
We really can all see so many of the things that keep families up at night: childcare, healthcare, poverty wages, clean air and water, all of these issues really can be resolved if we come together and use the power of our collective action, what we simply can't solve on our own. And philanthropy has such a core role to play in that.
You've written in your book that racism hurts. It hurts us all, but diversity could be our superpower. Tell us what you mean by that and what it can mean for social and economic structures.
Basically, when we bring together people who see the world slightly differently, we tend to see the whole picture, the full 360, right? If we're not all looking at the problem from the same direction and the same viewpoint. That is something that should be a natural resource for the United States, right? In ethnically diverse nations in the country, we are, as I said, soon going to be a country with no racial majority. All of that is where we can really see the potential maximized by bringing in values of diversity, equity, and inclusion into our sense of the common good.
I was so excited to learn that you're about to publish an adaptation of your book for young readers. I believe that is great, and I'm sure it will be an inspiration and uplifting for people. How did you decide to do that, and why? And what are you hoping young readers will learn from your book?
I thought about my own education, an excellent education, and yet there was so much that I didn't understand and didn't know about who we are to one another, about our common history, about the ways that racism is not a zero sum, that it has had costs for everyone. These themes are so important for young people to know as they learn history, because that makes it relevant to today. But I think about, you know, a way to look at our economy and history through the lens of racial equity, but not one that's about us versus them, one in which all students can really see themselves in the story of how we've gotten to where we are and how we can get to a better place together.
Thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a great conversation. I just wish you the best, Heather, and thank you so much for celebrating this National Day of Racial Healing with us and with the nation and the world.
Thank you, Lejeune. Thank you for your leadership. Congratulations on all that you've done. It's been a pleasure to be a part of commemorating this day. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us today for our 6th annual National Day of Racial Healing. We have just a few more minutes to go, but I hope you have found this refreshing, informative, and inspiring. I am so pleased to see and experience the depth of work being done. Our panelists encouraged us to heal by building solidarity across racial lines. They gave us a path forward to address the systems that create disparities for children and families in all of our communities. And we saw again today how racial healing and racial equity are a journey. There's always more distance to travel, and every single person is needed on the journey. It is exciting to imagine the possibilities ahead of us. A special thanks to everyone who shared their talents and traditions. Your participation grounds us in the richness of our diversity and helps us see the sacredness in each other more fully. It was so meaningful to see our friends in Flint talk about how the Truth, Racial Healing, and Transformation process played a role in relationship building and change after the water crisis, which was a formidable environmental injustice. All of our communities face crises and challenge born of racism. In Flint's story, we see the kind of transformational and sustainable change that's possible when residents and leaders engage in racial healing. I encourage you to join us in this work and start your own racial healing journey. I challenge you to think boldly. Consider the power of the possible and work in solidarity. This is how we bridge the divides to transform communities for our children and future generations. This is how we heal.
Why is one man rich and another man poor? Why we ain't satisfied? Why we gotta have more? Why your suicide rates on the rest so high? Why I tell you the truth, but you say don't lie? Why is being a good father at an all-time low? Why is it acceptable? Yo, why I don't know? Why she blame him and he blame her? It's useless. Ask yourself this question. Why you making excuses? Why do parents gotta bury their kids? Why we text and drive, not caring how scary it is? Why it's so hard to forgive and leave the past behind? And if you did, then that's divine. Why don't you help your brother when you see him fall? Why do we act like God don't see it all? Why do we call them black, them white, them Asians and use labels? Now that's racism.
I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo,
why? Why is there innocent people locked up for life while some people
people can't say nothing nice. Why do we always gotta question what all of it means? And why won't you follow your dreams? Tell me why, the night when you took my dad, why'd you let me see my grandpa cry? And tell me why, and why do you choose to hide, even though you was born to fly? And tell me why, and why don't we turn from all the hate? And why don't we learn from all mistakes? Why do I keep on wrecking these fat beats? And teachers don't make more than professional athletes. And why, and why, and why?
How you wanna hold when they know what? How you wanna hold when they know what?